goal of this project is to capture the knowledge and experiences from change leaders to help inform other departments and colleges in transforming their STEM programs. We interviewed 8 individuals from institutions across the country. We asked them to share their advice on tracking progress and data. This is what they had to say.
Besides just general surveys and focus groups, and then looking at the data from your programs, if you have academic support, like track the students. Not tracking in the education research sense, because that's evil, but tracking. And like we did with CS Scholars, where, you know, initially people would want to look at the data and say, well, how are CS Scholars performing to the average student in 61A? Well, that's an inappropriate comparison, because the average student in 61A has like 3.5 years of experience, and somebody had 7, like if you averaged out. So we wound up implementing a survey in the class, which I think is a really powerful tool to survey the class and ask them, how much programming experience did you have before? Did you take APCS? Did you take a different CS class? If so, fill in the blank. What was that? Just in case we get some trend of class that we didn't know existed that we could change the survey later.
One thing I often encourage department leaders to do is to make sure they understand their numbers closely, because if you don't know where your challenges are, then you can't do an intervention to it to address some challenge. So one thing I noticed at Mines when I analyzed the numbers is that we had approximately 21% of our acceptances for students who applied to Mines interested in computing went to females. But then when I looked at the enrolled students, under 17% of them were females. So we accepted a much larger percent of our applicants than what we enrolled. And so that's a problem, right? You want the accepted percent to be approximately the same as your enrolled percent. So once I saw that particular challenge, I talked to some people at Mines of what can we do about this? We got to address. This is a challenge. This is an issue. How can we fix it? And we decided to implement Zoom calls with current women in computer science, reaching out to the prospective women who were interested in computer science. So that group of accepted students, we reached out to them, invited them to a Zoom call, and I had a number of women from our ACMW group, for example, and other women that are role models within the department participate on those Zoom calls. And then the following year, we looked to see how we did, and the percent of enrolled women went up to 24%. Just by doing that intervention. And so again, you have to understand your data, see where your challenges are, and then address them.
Okay, so first you have to have your data. You have to know who's in your program, who's in your classes, and what happens to them as they experience their journey through your system. That's the key, that's the most important thing. You can't just look at how much money you spend on tutoring, for example, or advising. It really has to be with what are the interactions, what actually is happening in the classroom, what are the grades students are getting, is there differences between different demographics of the students in terms of the outcomes.
So we are collecting a lot of information, especially from faculty, and that's been some really important data, but it has been hard in terms of making sure that we're consistent in what we're asking for and that they're able to get it to us, especially since they're so busy. When it came to working with students, some of them are seeing IRB approved consent forms multiple times. So that's been something that has come up in terms of making sure that we have data from them, but making sure we're also not overwhelming them.
We're collecting a lot of stuff right now. We're very interested in the effects on underrepresented groups. And so sometimes that data is hard to come by. But lucky for us, we're working directly with the department head, and she has access to that kind of data. So it's things like DFW rates, drop, fail, or withdraw rates, including whether or not they're members of underrepresented groups and which ones. And then we collect individual grades for different assignments. Those have to come from all different kinds of faculty. That's a huge sense-making effort on our part, but we managed to get a grant from NSF, which is supporting us so that we can have all this help. Let's see, what else are we collecting? Ah, the student surveys. Ooh, so these are data we collected from students about how included they felt in their courses and their teams before and then after when we started doing this stuff.
InCWIT's tracking tool was invaluable for us. And if you can measure it, you can change it. And so we thought, you know, we knew that we were doing better, but having that tracking tool to where we were forced to put our numbers in every year and to see the growth was huge. Sometimes you have such limited resources that you can either do programs or you can track your progress. So it is hard. It's hard, but it's important. And especially with limited dollars and limited time, you know, to find ways to make sure where you're putting your efforts is what really matters. You know, we have our summer camps, we track who comes, who then applies to UT, who gets accepted, who enrolls. And, you know, we've been able to see over the years that, yes, we are making an impact, you know, going from first year, 3 students came and then 7 and then 10, now 20. And we can go to our supervisor and say, this program matters. You know, we get 25% of our incoming class of women went to one of our summer camps.
I think that there's kind of 2 separate things here. One is tracking demographics. I think really trying to get an idea of who is in your department or who's in your major to begin with. And that's not just students. I think tracking demographics of faculty and staff is also really important to get an idea of, you know, who is represented in your program. And when you think about demographics, you know, it's not, you really should be thinking about lots of different groups of people. So, for example, a lot of departments will only look at underrepresented minority students as a whole. But there are a lot of different races and ethnicities that are actually represented in the URM category. And so it's really important to disaggregate that data and really look at specific populations of folks. One of the common misconceptions, I think, in higher education, though, is increasing diversity is going to automatically increase inclusion in your department. So the thought is, oh, if you increase the number of women in the department, then it's just going to be a more inclusive place. Obviously, there's going to be more diversity of thought and ideas, which is great, but that doesn't automatically mean that you are going to have an inclusive environment that's going to be inclusive for everybody. So in terms of other tracking, you know, I think it's really important to do climate surveys. We usually do a climate survey every 2 years to really get a sense of our students and how they're feeling about the department. And again, we disaggregate that data by student population to get a sense of how is the general student population feeling and how are specific groups feeling. So I think that that's a really important part. The other thing that I think is important is looking at data and surveying students who are in particular support programs. I think a lot of times there's an assumption that, you know, you create the support program and you create the student group and it's automatically great. But it's really important to actually see what type of impact you're making, even for the things that interventions that you are trying to achieve.